Welcome back, Guardians, to the 25th episode of the DTR Podcast. I am your host, Jay, the content manager here at DTR. And joining me this week are my wonderful co-hosts. We have Dan.
Hi!
Welcome back. And Pubin.
I'm sorry I can't hear anybody because Dan just blew my eardrums out, but hello.
Welcome.
Star Wars hype!
Star Wars hype, yes. I saw your Twitter earlier today, just all Star Wars tweets. Well, J-Rem and Plasmic will not be joining us this week, but J-Rem will be back next week, but Plasmic will be back sometime in May. So our guests this week are, we have Lulu Soccer.
Hello.
Welcome. And the Buster Knuckle from the RNG cast.
What's going on, guys? How's everybody?
Welcome back to the show, Buster.
Hey, man. Thanks.
Welcome, Lulu. Alright, guys. So, we have a great show in store for you guys tonight, but before we get started, I do have a few announcements to say. You guys can find the DTR Podcast on iTunes, Podbean, and the Google Play Store at Destiny Tracker Podcast. We do record the show every Friday at 8 p.m. Eastern live on twitch.tv/DestinyTrack. If you would like to support the show, subscribe on iTunes and leave a review, and follow us on Podbean. Oh, Cuban.
I didn't know you were that easily distracted.
Make sure to check out the other podcasts here at DTR. We have the RNG cast, Destiny Lore cast, Destiny Down and Under, Destiny Massive Breakdown, and Rabbit Hole. All right, guys. So, yep, you can find all of those podcasts on iTunes and Podbean. So, Dan, would you like to tell us a little bit about Level Up Foods?
I would once my computer's on.
All right, so... Lulu, let's start off with you. Tell us a little bit about yourself. What do you do here in the Destiny community?
I mainly stream in the mornings. I've been a streamer for about 2 years now. Actually, it's 2 years starting yesterday, actually, was my 2-year anniversary on Twitch.
Nice,
well, happy anniversary.
Yeah. And I mainly, actually, my channel mainly, we just stream a few hours in the morning, and we mainly do raid helps, and sometimes trials helps. But a lot of times, just we focus on the PvE content, mostly. Destiny has always been my mainstream game, but sometimes we'll kind of, like, venture into other games and things like that. But mainly just Destiny, PvE. We do PvP too, but we do a lot of raid helps. That's pretty much what I do.
Nice. Now, Mr. Buster, tell us, what do you do here in the community, man?
Oh, man, I'm one of the hosts of the RNG cast with my boys Des Raven and the Businessman 24. I am the captain of the team Telesto and the principal of the Positivity. To be honest, I mean, I've seen a lot of game communities, and the Destiny community is really, really positive, which I dig. But I mean, you know, you can always be more positive. So, you know, I'm a big fan of self-talk, you know, let's go, baby, that kind of thing. And I'm the hardcore patrol master. If you want to get some Vanguard levels, let me know. I can. I average about almost two an hour. I can get to with three people on a fire team. I just know how to do it, man. It's easy. But generally, the RNG cast.
Yeah. Well, how do you level up to an hour in the Vanguard? I'm curious.
Well, you grab all the bounties, which is okay. The first step. Always grab all the bounties and grab Shiro bounties. And then you can typically, obviously, do all the Shiro bounties in the Plague Lands. And then you do the Plague Lander bounty in the Plague Lands as well. And that's almost a half. It's a little over a half of a rank up. And then if you do all the Shiro bounties, that's a full rank plus like a quarter, almost to a half. Then bust the other ones. And by the time you do all that plus the patrols themselves, easy.
Nice.
So I just looked at the bottom line of chat, and I just all I saw was Lulu said, "Hey, hey stupid," and I was like, "Whoa, why are we being so mean to people?" She seems so nice, but she's just calling
me. That was his username.
And then I looked up. I was like, "Oh, he is stupid."
Yeah.
Oh my goodness! I just realized that too. So I just like said what his name was. I wasn't even. Oh my gosh!
There's a guy that we've helped to the lighthouse before whose username is Dumb, and I'm like, Dumb, come over here. Dumb, why are you doing that? I know what it's like.
Oh man. Yeah, I saw that. So Pubin, what question do you have for our two wonderful guests this week?
Well, you know, so Lulu, I've been watching your stream for the longest time. I'm a huge fan of your stream and your content. I love the way you interact with viewers, and you know, I like to think that doing trials helps with people can be frustrating at times, but I can't even imagine how frustrating doing raid helps can be for most people. You always seem to stay so positive. Mm-hmm. And how do you manage to stay so positive? And I'm kind of curious, like, what is your most proud accomplishment or moment on stream or in Destiny?
Well, I think the positivity thing is just, for me, is I just have like a huge love for the actual Destiny game itself. I've never been tired doing a raid. Like, I've never even gotten bored of Destiny. Like, I've never taken a break from it. I've played it since the beta. So I think part of that is I just don't get bored doing it. And I enjoy helping others get, like, learn the strats for the raids. One of the major things for me is I don't like it when people like to cheese things. So we never teach any kind of cheese strats in my stream. We teach people like how to utilize like their supers, like what weapons to use, like heavies, things like that, and like strategies positioning wise. So people can easily like beat the encounters without cheesing. So that's one of the main things I prefer, is to teach people how to do those encounters like successfully without like the cheesy methods. Because back in year one, I used LFG all the time, and that's one of the most frustrating things, was like everybody always wanted to cheese everything, and I've been a part of that. I've cheesed everything before, but I didn't like it. Like, I didn't want to do that. So I think part of the platform of being in Twitch is that I can like teach all these guardians like how to do it without doing the cheese methods, and I think it's, people feel a lot more accomplished when they can do that. You know, the building the bridge at Crota is actually a really fun encounter. So having people not cheese that is, you know, it's just a lot of fun. So I don't know, I guess just the positivity thing is just you just have to realize that not everybody plays the game as much as I do. So not everybody can play 3 to 4 hours every day. You know, they have families, jobs, school, things like that. So you know, you can't get frustrated at somebody if they're just trying to learn, you know, the strats. It doesn't mean I don't get frustrated. I have been frustrated before. You know, everybody does at times. I know when King's Fall first dropped a long time ago, I actually took like a little break from doing King's Fall help, because it sometimes does get to a point where King's Fall can be very frustrating. Part of it is like it can be glitchy, laggy. There's just some things with that. So it doesn't mean that I don't get frustrated. It's just I try not to get frustrated, because it's silly to get frustrated over it at times. So I really try not to. And in terms of my proudest accomplishment, oh my gosh, a personal accomplishment was when I got Max Grimoire. I still remember that day. It happened a few months after I started streaming, actually, when I early streaming. And I had been trying to do that for a little while, actually. So for me, that was a personal accomplishment in the game, just because I had been going for that for a while. And I didn't know if I'd ever be able to get the Rumble wins for that. So the fact that, like, I won one game one time, and I was like, well, if I can win one, I can win 100. And so then I eventually won 100 of them. So that was my personal accomplishment. In terms of stream, though, and stuff like that, it's just watching Guardians go from, like, not knowing, like, the mechanics of the raid to, like, week one, and then we work with them every week, and then, like, by week five, they, like, know how to do everything. So I think that's a really good feeling for that. So just that, I guess.
Beautiful. That was like absolutely beautiful. Very well said.
Nice answer. I like that answer. Mm-hmm. So what got you into streaming?
When I first started streaming, actually, it was just like for fun. I was just working on my Max Grimoire, and I was just you know, just streaming with some friends that I had met. It was like when I first initially started, like, I had no idea the stream would become to what it was today, like what it is today. We started it was just for fun. And then the stream kind of started to grow and things like that. And so then we kind of like, I started like being like, well, maybe this could actually be more than just like a fun little thing I do just to play the game with. And so then we started doing Skola's help, actually, because people didn't know how to do Skola's, I found. So we started helping people with Skola's. And then the raids, and it just kind of grew to what it is today, actually. So when I initially started, I had no plans for the stream. There was nothing, like, it was just, I just hit stream one day, and then, like, it just kind of grew to what it is today, so.
Yep. Nice. Congrats. Mm-hmm. Now, Buster, so what got you into podcasting? Why did you create the RNG Cast?
That's actually a long story, but the short version of before I was on the RNG Cast, I was on another Destiny podcast, The Agents of the Nine, and that kind of the other two hosts kind of fell off of Destiny, which is understandable. People do that. It's, you know, whatever. And I've had the podcasting bug ever since, and I remember playing Destiny one day, talking to Des Raven, and I was like, "Man, I want to do a podcast. Would you be down to do that?" And he was like, "Oh, for sure, let's do that." And I was like, "We need three. We need a third." And because I don't know, I just like three Musketeers. You know, the three amigos. That kind of you know, all that. And I was like, the Three Stooges. That's also a plot applicable. And I was like, who would be good? And we both said at the exact same time, the businessman. And I was like, well, I mean, that's serendipitous. Let's go. And I asked him, and he was like, yeah. And, you know, that's history. We're almost a year in now. We hit 40. I think tomorrow will be episode 48.
Woo!
So, nice. So
we're creeping up. We're marching towards that 52. And, I mean, we haven't missed a year. We haven't missed a week. We don't miss any weeks, you know, sick, hungover, hurt, whatever. We're holidays. We always find time to talk to each other and, you know, put it out there for everybody.
Buster, you got to tell them about the first week I was on, what you did in order to be on the podcast that week.
Was it when I fell down the steps, when my dog tripped me down the steps?
Yeah.
Yeah, I I was in the emergency room, and I left.
Yeah.
Like, the doctor was like, "You can't leave," and I'm like, "Yeah, I can. I have to go." So I was like, watching the clock, and I was like, I gotta go. And I banged myself up pretty good because I have a large dog. I have a German Shepherd, and she was on her way down the steps, and I was behind her, and she turned real quick, and I kind of went ass over tea kettle and smacked the back, like, where my kidneys are on the railing, and, you know, I took myself to the emergency room because some things were wrong, and the doctor was like, you can't leave, and I'm like, oh, I can leave right now, and he was like, no, you can't, and I just, you know, pulled it off, and I walked out.
Damn, son.
And then went on the podcast for 2 hours.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Strong man. I like
Bruce
that.
Ribs and all.
Strong like bull.
I wouldn't say that. I was hurting. I wasn't feeling good. But, you know, the show must go on. we were all members of the DERP, the Destiny Reset podcast fam, and you know, they're a bunch of great guys and a great community, and I guess we're considered cousins, I guess, because, you know, we came from them, so, you know, we say we're cousins of the DERP fam, the RNG Revolution, and you know, we just kind of hit it off. Raven and I are lore nerds, and we were always talking about lore and all kinds of other fun stuff, and that's just how it happened, man. Like, I met two of the best friends I could ever ask for from Destiny. So, I'm loyal. I don't play any other game but Destiny.
Same. I like that. Except Overwatch, but that's a whole different
story. I don't play anything but Destiny.
Overwatch is so much fun.
It is. I just reached level 25, but this is a Destiny podcast.
Listen, man. Oh, we talked about Destiny, but we can mention, you know, other games and other things that are going on, you know, like Star Wars.
Truth.
No. All right, guys, so let's get into the show. So let's start off with our weekly activity segment. This week's Nightfall is the Abomination Heist. The modifiers are Epic, Berserk, Small Arms, Chaff, and Fresh Troops. Go out there, do that Nightfall, and get you guys a nice icebreaker.
Or not.
Or, yeah,
have you gotten one yet, Lulu?
Yes.
Okay.
I have.
Well, try to get yourself a nice icebreaker.
Buster, have you gotten an icebreaker? Are you trying to get one?
Who, me?
No, Buster.
Oh,
I have two. I had two drop in the same week.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not a sniper, but I'm a collector, so I'm obsessed.
Yeah, same. Alright guys, so let's get into the raid. So this week's weekly feature raid is King's Fall. King's Fall has... Wow, I dropped my mic. Oh man.
Careful there, bud.
So King's Fall has three challenges. There is War Priest Gogi. Yeah, I like to call him Gogi. And Oryx. So, Dan, let's start off with you, man. How has your experience been this week in King's Fall?
It's been a mixed bag.
Okay.
Raid College. Ah, man. I've dropped out of Raid College twice this week, and it feels bad. On Tuesday we had... It was just glitching out right at Oryx. Where we'd have all the damage in, we'd explode all the bombs. He'd go to middle and then push off and just be like, bye guys, see you later. I'm glad you came to visit me. And it just, I just spent a lot of time in there. And yesterday we were at Totems for a while.
About 2 hours.
And it's like, wow. I love that raid, but I think it's, I love that raid. But I think it's because of who I ran it with originally, like the clan that I was in, and like kind of making the friends that I did with that within my clan, like Detective Tugs, who had to get a coloring book after he couldn't down Oryx for a while, like Lotar, who had to deal with us all, and Hockey would get upset, but like he's always like this well-intentioned dude. It was that I actually cared about, and less so the raid. I don't know. It's just I feel like a broken man. I don't know.
Well, before I tell my story, do you mind explaining each challenge? War Priest, Gogi, and Oryx?
Sure, yeah. Right. War Priest, it's just two people can't hold the aura. The same person can't hold the aura twice when you're doing damage phases. So you have to at least... You can two-phase him still. So two people have to hold it while everybody does DPS. That's the challenge for the first one. The second one, Golgoroth, you have to have... everybody has to catch his gaze, which we achieve by... somebody stands on the box in the back. The first person stands on the box in the back. Everybody does DPS in the bottom, except for the one person dodges out about five seconds out from when the pool disappears, or the gaze disappears. He pops in the back, starts running around. I call it the NASCAR left NASCAR lap because you only turn left. And as he spins around, everybody tags him, grabs the gaze, keeps going around the circle. Kings, the Oryx fight, you have to explode all 16 bombs at the same time in order to get DPS in. You don't do it after each phase, which is honestly the best way to beat Oryx, or at least in my opinion, because you don't have to run around any pillars or anything, and it makes it a little bit smoother, except for when he decides to glitch, and like because somebody shot him with an Outbreak Prime, and he just shows up in the back of the room as well. It's like a personal story. Oh my god, I'm so. I try not to be salty. I try to be.
You are salty.
Where are the nuts, Dan? Oh, where are the nuts? Where are the nuts?
So I ate them all. I ate them all yesterday.
Okay.
I love you guys. I'm sorry. I try not to be salty, but yeah, this week has broken me. But I love you all. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So yesterday Dan and I spent 2 hours at Totems, but it was a fun experience. I would say. I just want to give a shout out to, I think his gamer tag was the old man 411. Yeah. He's a bit of an older dude, but he was calm. And he said something which made me really emotional. He realized that we were a bit stressed out, and he said, if you guys want to kick me, just go ahead, because that's what most fire teams do. And that really touched my heart. Like, I know it was just a small sentence, but that really touched my heart, because I felt so bad, because, well, we weren't going to kick him out, but just the fact that he thought of that, just, I'm very sensitive.
No, it was just a long encounter. We were in there for a long time, and just small things started getting to us. It had nothing to do with anybody's ability. Old man hadn't run it that much before, so there was a little bit of inexperience there. But otherwise, it was fine. It was just small things started adding up again. Once we started getting it down, it just I love you guys.
All right, Lulu, how was your experience this week in King's Fall?
To be honest, my experience this week in King's Fall has actually been pretty good.
Nice.
For the most part, our runs have all been pretty smooth. I've done about 6 or 7 runs this week, and it really hasn't had major issues. Although I will say, Oryx can be laggy like that encounter. I haven't had too many problems this week, but I know in the past before. Orcs can just be kind of annoying, but to be honest, this week I find it was pretty good. It's pretty smooth. The only thing I was slightly disappointed in the King's Fall raid is, and I guess I shouldn't have realized that nothing was really going to change, but I was I was kind of hoping the encounters would have been slightly different. It didn't feel any different to me than King's Fall back when it was released. Even the 390 version, at being the higher late, it actually didn't feel any harder. Like, it felt the same, you know.
Yeah.
Warpriest still died in 2 phases, like what he did before. Golgi's, I mean, everybody died in like this. I don't know. I just didn't feel any different. The only thing that was annoying is the knife you can't one shot with your regular sniper. You have to use a high impact one. But it just didn't feel different. Like, I just kind of wanted, like, you know, Crota and Vogue, they felt fresh and new and different, and King's Fall just kind of felt like it was the same. So I knew a lot of people were like, I don't even really want to run King's Fall because they had bad memories before in King's Fall. And they're like, but I don't know, I had a good week with it so far, so it's not been bad.
Nice. I saw a Reddit post earlier this week where someone said that, like, they weren't looking for like, the reason why a lot of people weren't looking forward to King's Fall is because it was the only raid that we had for around a year that could get us up to the current light level, so everybody has just spent a lot of time there, and I'm glad that they had Iron Banner this week, because that was a good reprieve.
I'd say that might have been strategic, right there.
Yeah, and I think so.
This is the one people probably want the least. We'll throw Iron Banner in there.
Yeah,
yeah.
People can go mix it up in there.
Yeah. All right, Buster, your experience this week in King's Fall.
I haven't raided this week. Right. I am, I work 12 to 15 hours a day, so my day is Saturday to play, or in the mornings after my workout, and I've been playing Iron Banner, because you can get, you know, 3 or 4 matches of Iron Banner in within the hour I have before I have to get ready for work, so you gotta make choices, man. My job gets in the way of my Destiny time, and it's a bummer, but I always find some time to play.
Are you going to run King's Fall tomorrow?
Before 8 p.m.? Yeah, I think I might try to.
Nice.
I have a trials date.
Oh, yeah.
I have a trials date at 8 p.m., so I'm hype.
Nice.
That is the thing that about this raid, though, that can be a negative, too, is I feel like, so, I mean, if you run it with a normal group, you can do it in an hour or less, you know, but if you run it with, like, you know, LFG or new folks, things like that, the raid can take, I mean, hours. Like you said, you spent 2 hours at Totems. You still had 4 more encounters to go after that. So this raid can be definitely a challenge for some people who only have an hour to play. Like, they can't get too far. That's one of the things. It is definitely, like, it's a really long raid. So,
yeah,
I tell people.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I tell people it's a gift and a curse, me not being able to play so much. It's a curse because, obviously, I can't play the game I love, but it's a gift because I don't get burnt out.
Yeah.
How people are like, oh, I play like 4 or 5 hours a day, and I'm like, I'm so tired of the game. I'm like, great, I'm not. I don't have the time. I mean, people like with I love when people are like, oh, I can play 3 hours a day and I'm still like Lulu, like you said, you play like what, 3-4 hours a day and you still aren't burnt out. That's beautiful. Yeah. I fucking love hearing that. But I understand, you know, it's like, it's a double-edged sword. I understand if you have the time to play, you're going to play the game, you're going to get burnt out. There's people that I know that have 100% completed the book. And I just have to say to them, are you going to say that you're bored? Because obviously, if you say you're bored, I'm going to say to you, well, you should have took your time on the book. Like, you know, it's one of those things.
Yeah.
But the book is a beautiful thing. I love it.
Yeah, it is.
It makes you do everything.
It's a. I just hit 100% yesterday on it, and I'm like, I can't wait to get that T-shirt in a couple weeks when my paycheck comes in. But yeah, it's the game's still wonderful and beautiful. But you play very differently than most people, Buster, or at least most people that I know. I guess I should say it that way, because you maximize your time. You found the specific activities that you can do within your hour or your limited space to get the most out of it for you, and like that's super cool, man.
Oh yeah, that's the reason why I have 6,000 strange coins.
Damn.
Well, now I only have 4,000. I spent 2,000 this week, but
on what?
Three of coins and heavy ammo synth, so I can get my future war cult rank up to 24, so I can get that check mark in the book.
Get that check mark in the book.
Yeah. You know who doesn't need to go to the tower to grab heavy ammo synth? This guy, because I have 700 on hand at all times.
Oh my gosh!
And I have I think I have like 1,200 in the vault, so I'm ready to go. And if I find a good weapon,
like Gary's gonna blow all that up. I hate to tell you.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Nah, I'm okay with that.
You might want to go unbanked.
Yeah, that's why I'm spending them. That's why I'm spending them free will. You know, Gary's gonna come and destroy everything. So I'm just gonna say, all right, cool, Gary, you do that. I'm gonna have the highest new monarchy rank. Because if you don't get the assembly too, I'm gonna look down upon you.
So, but what if the API is down and you can't get your heavy synths from the vault? I have
700 with me.
Wow.
Yeah, I have like 700 with me at all times.
He is ready.
Yeah.
There is no. I'm like the best Boy Scout ever. I'm always prepared, but I was never a Boy Scout because I got kicked out.
Oh, yesterday I went into King's Fall with 2 heavy synths. Yeah.
That's 98 too little.
On PlayStation, I'm new to PlayStation, so I don't have a lot of materials and stuff.
So, I mean, I wouldn't know that, Jay. We're not friends on PlayStation. I mean, I would think that
let's be friends on PlayStation. Okay.
I would think we would be friends on PlayStation, right?
Let's be friends. So, Pubin, how was your King's Fall experience this week?
I didn't do it.
Okay. So. So first of all,
I know, right?
my raid group. Okay, I'm gonna call these bitches out. Okay,
hey,
it's DT, Sweep the Legs, Flockstar, Hanuman, and Jaden are my raid group. Like we, you know, that's like the squad. And so every Tuesday or Wednesday, as these refresh raids have been coming out, it's like, all right, guys, we're gonna meet up, we're gonna hold hands, and we're gonna go do this and blah blah blah. And this, like, first of all, I had to convince people, specifically DT. DT was like, no, fuck King's Fall, man. Fuck King's Fall sucks, man. That's the worst raid. And I'm like, dude, let's do it. And then finally everybody got on board, and then someone had to work. And so I just haven't been motivated to, like, put a team together. And I'm just like, yeah, I did so much King's Fall.
Yeah.
I'm excited to do Wrath. I haven't done Wrath in a while, so I'll do Wrath next week. I'll do King's Fall once for the book, but... It is the raid that I was looking forward to the least.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, how do you guys feel about Wrath? It's only going up, what, like 10 light? I know Axis is what only... It's the only 390 part of that raid right now, right? I think, right? Correct me if I'm wrong.
I don't think it's going to feel very different.
No.
It's just... Mm-mm.
Yeah,
you know.
I don't think it's going to feel...
I don't think so.
Oh, I hate Bossic. The only challenge I need to do is Axis. So, I'll do that Tuesday every.
They're not updating anything to the challenge modes for Wrath, right? Just like King's Fall was the same.
No, it's just King's. The whole just like King's Fall.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Just 5 light levels up.
Yeah.
It's gonna be the same. It's gonna feel the same. Honestly, I just think I like Wrath as a raid like infinitely better than I raid. Like King's Fall. It is up there with Vog for me. It's they're neck and neck for the best raids in my opinion.
After this week, I'll second your opinion.
I cannot wait to get those new adept primaries, adept primaries from Wrath. They look nice. So let's talk about Wrath. Lulu, are you excited for Wrath?
I am excited for Wrath. So Wrath, it's up there with me too in Vog for my favorite raids. I've loved Wrath ever since it was first released. I think it's the perfect length. I think the encounters involve, you know, you can use less guardians, you know, but they have a specific job for every guardian. I don't know, I just really, really have always enjoyed Wrath. I think it's the loot drops have been like were amazing in Wrath. I mean, all the chests, everything. Like, I thought it was a really well put raid. It was one of my favorites. I've done it many, many times. So
I felt like it just has a really good energy. Like, it's just it's exciting and it's really fun.
Yeah,
like,
it is.
Just the I don't know. Like, they're all fun, sure, but just the vibe of Wrath is just on another level. Even I think it's more fun to do than Vogue, but the depth of Vogue is what the scope and the depth and the just, you know, like they're great for different reasons to me. But Wrath is really, really exciting.
It's just more kinetic. Wrath is just more kinetic. It's an action movie. It's Michael Bay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, Lulu, I don't know if you remember, but I did run Wrath with you back on Xbox a few months ago, actually. This is like October. Yeah, you don't remember. It was a long time ago.
Wait, what's your Xbox username?
I don't like to say it, but it's like JMC.
Say it, Jay!
JMCBoy123. It was on Twitter. Yeah.
It's McBlack!
About doing it.
Yeah, it was back when you were like, I think we were like 363. It was when you first started out on Xbox.
Oh, yeah? Oh, yeah. And I got like super carried?
Yeah.
Super carried.
That, it was a long time ago. Anyway, Dan, Buster, are you excited for Wrath, man?
Oh, man, you guys are going to hate me. That's my least favorite raid.
What?
Yeah, I mean, I agree that it's kinetic and it's fun to play and all that. And I mean, you know, it's the lore and all that. My favorite raid's Crota. That's like a strike
mission. That's not even a raid.
Economy of time. That's what Buster's talking about.
We took a 5-year-old through Crota and he killed him with the sword. He was the sword bearer. So I love Crota so much.
That was Mulder's son, right?
Yeah, that was Mulder's son.
Yeah,
that was,
awesome.
That was Big G as a. I lovingly call him. He's my little buddy, but he's the head of the Buster Knuckle Junior fan club. I love that kid, but I mean, I was more excited than he was that he killed Crota because if the clip is on the RNG Cast Twitter, I think we have it pinned or something, and you can hear me scream. Like I screamed like it was the greatest thing. Like it was the greatest thing in the world. It was sprinkles on ice cream to me, man. Like. The entire time, I was watching him stream the entire time. The camera was on him, and he was jumping on a little trampoline, like one of those mini trampolines, the entire time. He was just boom, 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 like a gummy bear, just bouncing. And I was just sitting there, and I was so amazed, and we were like, go get it. Dropping bubbles for him so he could just run through the bubbles. We down Crota. He would smash him twice, and we'd be like, run. And he would go, run, and run away. And then we would get him again, like, go get him. And he would get him. And then he down Crota, and I screamed, and I just love Crota. Plus, I love the way the ornaments look. I'm one of those guys.
Let's put that up on stream really quickly. Yeah, it looks nice. It looks nice. But I love the Vogue gear. I'm sorry. I think Vogue is the best. I love my little leg on my hunter. My little robot leg.
Well, yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
But Dan's right. Everything is about economy of time for me. If I can jump in the Crota and do it in an hour and a half as opposed to, you know... wiping on Axis 36 times and muting myself and screaming to the heavens.
You gotta get into one of my raid groups. We were not wiping on Axis 36 times. It was the first time.
Don't hook up with Lulu. She'll get you through in economy level time.
Oh my gosh.
There's been several times I've been the only one survive, you know, alive because I play a defender. I main defender Titan, and I'm in my bubble like, you guys are on your own. And then, oh, I'm down. I'm like, I can shoot a Scorch Cannon. I can throw the bomb. I can do this. And then somehow somebody misses, and, you know, once one domino gets knocked over, all 936 dominoes get knocked over. There's people cussing and screaming, and kids are saying, I'm going to go, you know, I got to go take a shower or something. It's just... me and raiding just don't... I don't know, man. It's the only time I get a little... I wouldn't say I get salty. I get a little super knuckle. Like, I get real, super real knuckle. I get real, real antsy. Because I'm not a raider, but I know all the mechanics. And I'm like, you guys raid all the time. How don't you know these mechanics? Like... For the sword, like in Crota, it took us 2 hours to down Crota when it was the challenge mode, and I was like, just down Crota, hit him twice, back off, we shoot him again, we shoot the Oversoul, hit him again, we run, and I said it all, and they're like, how come you don't raid all the time? I'm like, I know the raid, I've been playing since beta, I know all the raids, it's just, I get so frustrated with people. If you're not the sword bearer, don't talk, is how I have to say it to people. If you don't have the sword in your hand, that's a talking stick. They're the only person who talks. That's it. They're the captain now. Look at them. They're the captain now. But yeah, Lulu, I might have to jump into your raid group and just be like, I'm here. Put me in your backpack, coach. Let's go.
We have pretty smooth raid runs, I will say.
Here's a bubble. You want weapons? I got weapons and I got blessings. Which ones do you want?
Weapons.
There you go. Girl after my own heart. I don't ever take weapons off anyway. It's a trick question.
I prefer weapons anyways. I'm almost always, like, only occasionally blessing.
Yes, there's two defenders, and definitely one weapons, one blessing, because double weapons don't stack. If that's stacked, it would just be the most broken class in the world.
Oh yeah, that would be broken. Oh, let's not even talk about that.
But it would feel so good.
You get that melting point plus weapons, you get the damage. You can one phase axis, actually. We did it once.
Oof. Nice. Yeah. Nice.
The speedrun group. It's pretty
you gotta
cool.
Punch him.
Yeah. Alright, guys. So let's move on to our Trials of Osiris segment. Last week's map was the dungeons. So, Pubin, you're the Trials guy. So, tell us, how was your experience last weekend on the dungeons, man?
You know, Dungeons wasn't the worst map ever. The thing that made it difficult was, in general, the team that had the best zone control nades, right? So your lightning nades, your spike nades, things like that. They were able to kind of take the power point of the map pretty easily, because you spawn on either side of the map, and then everybody generally wants to push down into the belly of the map, which is where the cap point spawns, and thus is the main point you want to hold. But you're basically relegated to two really small doorways to come through. So in general, and some pretty just narrow areas overall. And so if you threw a really nice spike nade or a really nice lightning nade, you could really just mess up the other team's day. So oftentimes one team was just kind of relegated to going around the outside of the map a lot, trying to get angles through really narrow choke points, while the other team just kind of camped it up inside the belly of the map. So it had its share of difficulties with certain teams that played kind of that campy style. Particularly if you came across a really skilled team that played that campy style, it made it even harder to bust in because, you know, they knew the angles to hold down and they, you know, they're a little bit more seasoned in the game. But had some really exciting matches, got a lot of people flawless, a few people for their first ever flawless, which is always, you know, we've been putting a big emphasis on trying to take people who have never been. It had its share of difficulties, but we had a lot of success and overall I had a lot of fun. We played some really good games this weekend.
Nice. I didn't enjoy that map too much, but I just played to have fun. Lulu, did you play Trials last weekend?
I did one and a half cards. Yeah.
One and a half did. Cards. Alright, yes. Nice. Dan, did you attempt to play Trials last weekend, man?
I did not. It was a little late to get a thing going with Pubin, but I think we're gonna do that this week.
We're doing it right after this podcast.
Yeah. Don't miss it, guys.
I saw I watched it on a few different channels. It seemed like a weirdo map to me, personally. Everybody was struggling with it that first day. I don't think I saw anybody exactly know what to do. But it was good. From what I saw, it was fine. It was fine. I don't know. I'm gonna shut up now. I'm just.
I actually did enjoy the map. I was really concerned at first, but from the card that I did, I actually felt like you could play it different ways. You know, you could kind of rush down bottom B and get I don't know. I felt like it was good if you wanted to rush, if you wanted to kind of play a little bit more. I always usually rush, but you could play it more passive. I felt like it actually allowed for different weapons and playstyles, because it's actually it's kind of a. When I first thought the map, you know, you think it's kind of a larger map, but it's actually, the play areas are actually kind of small. So, I don't know. I liked it. I enjoyed it.
I find that happens on a lot of Trials maps where, it'll feel like if you look at the map, like, zoomed out, it's a large map. But in Trials, you know, a lot of the action centers around one small portion of what is generally a large map. And so I find that definitely happens a lot in Trials where... a lot of the map gets sort of underutilized.
Oh, sorry. I was reading chat. Lulu, I'll be at Guardian Con too.
Nice.
Yeah.
So will I.
Yes, Cuban will too. Yeah. We will be wearing the cool DTR shirts, but more information about that will be later. Buster, did you play Trials last weekend, man?
No, I didn't. Economy of time, my man. it's a general theme with me, but I will be playing this week at 8 p.m. with some amazing players. And, yeah. Yeah, Dark we've had. Puben, we might have to come on the RNG cast to talk a little bit.
Let's do it.
Oh yeah,
do it. It's a fun time. It's a fun time.
It is. All right.
You can talk all the Star Wars you want.
Yes.
All right, guys. So let's get into my favorite part of the show, where we guess how many kills. Sorry, a certain weapon got last weekend in the Trials of Osiris. So this week I want to do the top three weapons because we have a lot of time on our hands. So the first weapon we're going to guess will be, let's do Icebreaker. And it's going to be the lowest number you can guess is one kill, and the highest number you can guess, it's a lot of us, so I'd say about 10 million. Yeah. All right, so let's go. Oh wait, do you guys have any questions? Lulu, Buster.
I have no idea even the number range.
All right, it's a hint. It's in the millions. It is in the millions.
In the millions.
It's in the millions.
All right.
Alright, so the first weapon we're going to do is the Wormwood, and then I'll let you guys know the next two. Are you guys ready?
Yeah.
Alright.
Sure.
Buster, you're up first, man.
2.5 million.
So, 2.5? 2.5. Alright. Lulu.
I don't remember. I legit have no idea. I don't even know. I'm gonna say it's gonna have less than Icebreaker. That's my go-to. I'm gonna say it's only gonna have 1.5.
All right, Puben.
I don't even know what these numbers are.
wait, which one are we doing right
now?
We're
gonna do the Wormwood right now.
Well, Wormwood finished second, right? Wormwood finished second. Spoiler alert, guys. Icebreaker was probably first. Wormwood was probably second.
Yeah, I said Icebreaker had a lot, but I don't even know what a number like what the average is in Greek. I've never.
That's all part of the fun. Yeah, it's hard fun. And I have the price.
I'll actually say 1.5 is actually a pretty decent guess, I'd say. I'm going to go closer to 2, probably 1.9 is my guess.
1.9. All right, Dan.
$1.
He does that on RNG too, so don't feel bad.
All right, I do $1. This everywhere I go.
All right, Dan. All right, so the Wormwood received 2.2 million kills last weekend. So, Lulu, I guess you won.
I won?
Wait.
No, Puben won. He got 1.9.
Hello?
What did you say, Puben?
I said 1.9, fam.
Oh, I did not hear you say that. I'm an idiot. 1.9. All right, Pew.
You would think you that won. If one person was paying attention, it'd be the guy asking the question. I'm just saying. Did Wormwood finish first or second, though?
The special kills second overall. In the top 10, it finished third.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right, guys. The next weapon we're going to do is Icebreaker. Are you guys ready?
God damn it. Alright.
Oh, this is my favorite part of the show. Alright, Dan, let's start off with you.
So the last one was 1.9. Icebreaker, I'm gonna say 2.5.
Alright, Lulu.
I'm gonna go 3. I don't know. I feel like a 5. Three.
All right, and Cuban.
3 million.
All right.
3 million. I'm gonna go
3.25. It's a lot.
Did I win? I won! Yes!
You're going to Disney World!
Yes! Yes! I've been waiting.
I think, that's your first win, right, Dan?
That's my first win.
Your first win. GG, dude.
Congrats.
Thank you.
You're going to Hawaii. Thank you. Yeah.
I feel very lucky. I feel very lucky today.
Nice job.
All right, the Wormwood was the Icebreaker was the number one most used weapon last weekend in trials.
Most used or most kills? Overall,
both.
Even above primaries?
Yeah. Both.
Wow.
Yeah. That's pretty more crazy.
You know what's funny? I've been using Icebreaker for the last few weeks now. And last week, just because of the way encounters were going, I actually ended up going back to my bay. I went back to Last Word and my longbow. And matches in general were just playing slow enough that, like, if it was a, like, if both teams rushed and we were both there, then, like, Last Word would just eat people up in close range. But then if that didn't happen, then the match tended to play out really slow and special ammo would come up 30 seconds later. And so I actually had a lot of success running with Last Word and not running Icebreaker. It was pretty refreshing not to feel like I had to use the Icebreaker for the first week in like a month.
I'll just show you guys the next one. The Palindrome received 2.3 million kills. That was the most used primary.
Yeah.
Not surprised.
That's the top 3. Mm-hmm. I can read you guys the top 10. So first, of course, the Icebreaker, then Palindrome, then Wormwood, then Ias Luna, Mida, No Land, Blind Perdition, Hawksaw, The Last Sword, and then Blind Perdition again.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
They're all super strong
weapons in the top 10. Always the same.
Yeah. I mean, that's what's strong and that's what's accessible. You know, Palindrome... For the longest time, we had that amazing roll on sale from the Crucible vendor, and then after that, you had another great roll last week or the week before, was it, with the Icarus? So you know, it's a super accessible, really strong weapon. So you know, like that's what I expect. And then as far as you know, Mida's always been strong. No Land flinches hard, but it's still really strong.
Oh, yeah.
You know. Ias Luna, I think, is less accessible, but so many people have been grinding for it for so long now that a lot of people have gotten it. Mm-hmm. And the Luna's a beautiful thing, too.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and this week's map is Last Exit. It's a pretty good map. I actually like this map a lot. So good luck, Dan and Buster, this weekend with Cuban.
Thank you.
And Lulu, if you play Trials, good luck.
I play tomorrow. Really?
Nice. Good luck. All right, guys. So let's move on to Iron Banner. I know we kind of touched upon that earlier, but let's talk about it more. I barely played Iron Banner this week. I played about 2 matches with Dan last night, about 2 or 3. And then I played one on Xbox, so that's my Iron Banner experience. So Lulu, how was your Iron Banner experience, if you played?
I've played some. I'm rank 4 right now. Honestly, I usually like Iron Banner, but this week, maybe it's because I've done more solo, going in solo, but I feel like every match has been super sweaty, or it's been really, like, lopsided. Like, we get put with a whole team of 6, or I just feel like the matches just aren't, I don't know, they're just really not fun right now. Like, I just feel like every match is just, like, full of, like, it's just really, more try hard at the moment. I find I'm like having a difficult time. I've done all right with it, but like, I mean, I've definitely had like seven medallions earlier today trying to go in solo with it. Like, it put me into a match also like 19,000 to 6,000, and I'm like, what is this? Like, I mean, I'll take my medallion, but it's like, I don't know. It wasn't as fun going in solo. I think still, if you go in with a group, it's still the best way to enjoy Iron Banner. It's just play with friends with a group. But I mean, it's not been bad. Control is my favorite Iron Banner mode, so I was definitely excited to see that it was Control back this week. So, yep, I'm just doing get one or get rank 5 for my book. So.
Oh, that's right. The book requires rank 5, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep, gotta get it. That.
Yeah, now I have to play. Thanks. All right, Dan, how was your Iron Banner experience, man?
Mine has been really positive, but I've also been keeping my party open so that just anybody can join. So normally I'll have about 6 people on stream rolling in. I don't even know how many matches I played, but I hit rank 5 pretty quick. That Nightfall bonus really affects that.
That helps. I did not know that.
I got 500 rep.
Yeah. I got to rank 3 in 6 matches or something like that.
Holy potatoes.
Yeah, it was pretty bonkers. And that was actually the node that put me over the top to 100. But yeah, everything's been you get into a groove with a group of folks, and it felt good. As long as you control 2 points and not try to cap the third, I think you'll be fine. But yeah, solo queuing has got to be rough. I haven't done that for a while. Yeah.
I was doing it all this afternoon, and it was interesting. Oh, I mean, it was my own thing. I was just trying to like get some matches done, but I was like, man, this is rough. Like,
yeah. Oh man. Yeah, my heart goes out to you. I'm so sorry.
It's all good.
And Buster, how was your Iron Banner experience, man?
I have played some Iron Banner, so
that's right. Talk about it. Tell me, baby.
Let's go.
I played several matches throughout the week, and the first game I jumped in, I solo queued on Pantheon and got spawn trapped, and it was rough. But I had fun because I got a message from somebody that says, "Man, you and that Continental," because to steal Dan's line, that's my stable, baby. This week's role was amazing with Rodeo, Perfect Encounter. It's a laser beam.
Yes, and, it is.
The Continental, the Vanguard auto rifle.
I don't do auto rifles. I can't shoot them.
I just know the Continental from John Wick.
That's why I use it so much too. I love that movie. I'm off 3, I'm like 3.5 rank, and I've been having fun. Like, I fell out of PvP, I fell back into PvP, and now I'm back into PvP again. So, Control and Defender just kind of goes hand in hand. If you're a Defender and you're playing Control, it's pretty much like, oh, well, this game mode's my mode. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And I would either put, I'm the opposite of every Defender ever. I don't run no backup plans of shotgun. I run Telesto and either Helm of Saint 14 or the Armamentarium, because 2 suppressor nades are better than 1. But yeah, I had some really fun games. I did solo queue, and I met a few friends. You know, it was the guy that I ended up bringing into my clan, the Revolution. He was top, then me, then another guy, and I sent them messages like, "Hey, good game," and then they were like, "Oh, friend request." And I'm like, "Sweet, friend request." And we just teamed up and we run. So that was fun. And I got to run with Mulder and Scully, who Dan knows. Woo! And having someone who just picked up the game at like Taken King or Rise of Iron. Yeah, I think Scully started at Rise of Iron.
Yeah.
And hearing her, seeing her level, her light level progress, and hearing her ask all these questions about this and about this and about this, and we're like, oh, this is it. This is this. And then, you know, now her KD, you know, she hits games when she's like above one KD, which is pretty great. Watching somebody from a point, like 0.03 was one kill and like 29 deaths, and now she's running around, actually getting in and having fun. So it's really fun. I love Iron Banner anyway. I just, any reason why I can run Armor of Light and PvP, Weapons of Light and PvP makes me a happy man.
You're one of those titans.
Yeah.
He's the mosquito light. He's the mosquito lamp. Yeah. Everybody wants to go into it, but they always end up dying once they try to go in.
Yeah, come on in. I'll put the Helm of Saint 14. Everybody is welcome. But I've got the Proud Spire, which I don't use shotguns, so, you know. And a couple armor drops. I do want that unbent tree, though. I have several of them, but I'm an auto rifle guy. I can't shoot hand cannons, but I can shoot auto rifles. Okay. But yeah, it's fun. I love it.
Nice.
Anytime I can get a six stack, it's a great time.
Well, how was your Iron Banner experience, man?
So, you know, we mentioned Iron Banner last week, and it's so funny how, like, you can just take regular, you know, pub Crucible and just slap Iron Banner name on it, and everybody wants to come play it. You know, and that being said, like, you know, I played my main night of Iron Banner this week was Wednesday night. I did a stream Wednesday night, and you know, I was, because I, you know, I have school during the week and I have classes and stuff, and so usually when I stream during the week, it's like, you know, I'll hop on for like three, four hours, just get a little bit and, you know, hop off. And I ended up streaming for like 6 hours, almost 7 hours, and like next thing I look, it's like almost 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, shit, I got class in the morning. But like, I just had so much fun. Even though, so like, Lulu, man, you were speaking to me when you said that like solo queue was so horrible. Like when I started out, I was solo queuing and I was just like, what the crap is going on? These guys are the sweatiest tryhards I've ever played against. And when I do pubs, like I like to, like, because I try my butt off all weekend, like just sweating so hard on trials that like when I play pubs during the week, like I don't care. I just, you know, I play different classes that I don't usually play. You know, that's when I just kind of let my hair down, so to speak, even though I'm bald. But, like, you know, let my hair down and just kind of have fun. So I was rocking my Titan, which is my worst character. I am not a good Titan. And I'm there running hammers and running bubble and throwing stickies and just, you know, doing all sorts of, you know, stuff that I don't usually do in Destiny. But it was so sweaty. And then I picked up a team of just people from chat, and it was varying skill levels. But matches somehow got way easier. Like, I don't know. I think we won like 12 or 14 in a row. So, like, that was much, you know, much nicer. Obviously, winning is always fun. But, yeah, I had a good time. You know, drops don't mean anything to me. But, you know, just having fun running with, you know, just a lot of people and, you know, just shooting things. It's a lot of fun.
Nice. I'm hoping next month is like Mayhem class, because I saw, like I said last week, I saw in the patch notes that they talked about, they said Iron Banner now supports Mayhem class, so I'm hoping next Iron Banner is Mayhem class.
Yes.
Or it would be nice so to bad. See them end out D1 with a Mayhem class Iron Banner. Oh, okay, spin foil theory. Okay, okay.
Oh my god.
Okay, are you guys ready?
Lysander is coming to Iron Banner.
Great.
I'm not going to say anything about Lysander. Okay, okay. So, you know how the last 6 weeks of this game, there's going to be the Daybreak modifier. What if they add in the Mayhem Clash for Iron Banner in August, and then I guess that's a way for us using up all of our light. It's draining our light. We're using too much of our light, and we have no light at the beginning of Destiny 2 because we used it all. Something? No? I mean, all right.
I think Gary takes our light in the beginning of Destiny. I think that the Mayhem stuff is just
I tried.
Just Guardians having fun.
I tried. All right.
Yep.
It's just gonna be Lysander. I'm calling it out.
Drink.
So for anyone who's new to the show, I kind of say Lysander a lot. So a few weeks ago, they all said, "Hey, if I say Lysander, they're all gonna start drinking." So, Yeah.
I would if I had my my face warmers around here, but I don't.
For those of you not into the Grimoire very much, Lysander is a character from the Grimoire, which unfortunately, you know, a lot of awesome characters and stories are buried in the Grimoire of Destiny. But
he's one of the head of the Concordant.
Yeah,
the old faction.
The old faction, yeah.
Yeah. So, but Jay likes to mention him every podcast.
Every
it's like, you know,
episode.
if you look at the Destiny community podcast, right? So, you know, I watch their podcast every week, and you have like Tefty that always mentions Netcode. You have Holtz who always mentions World of Warcraft, and so it's like they have to mention it once every podcast, or else it's just not a true podcast. So, like our version of that is Jay mentioning Lysander.
Game of Thrones and EverQuest.
say what?
Oh, I was just gonna say Dan and his nuts.
Dan.
I haven't done that in a while.
We seem to bring it up every week. Is what I'm trying.
Yeah,
to
it does get brought up. It does get brought up. It is a meme. It is a meme within our community. But
his peanuts, guys. His peanuts get your minds out of the
guys.
Yeah, we should clarify. There's a lady present.
It's okay.
And well, Dan, you are a dirty Dan. You are known in DTR as being the dirty Dan. So,
well, I'm only known of that because you guys start calling me that. I don't know why. I mean, I guess I earned it on Monday during my stream, but I mean, it's fun.
Well, you know, when you walk on cam naked, you're gonna get that.
I just wanted to show you guys my scar.
Dan, don't feel bad. I'm the dirty one in orange.
He didn't really do that, as far as I know, anyway.
No, I didn't. I didn't do that.
All right, guys. Awesome Iron Banner talk, right?
Don't go in solo, basically.
Yeah, don't solo queue. Don't solo queue an Iron Banner.
Do not solo queue an Iron Banner, yeah. Oh, man. All right, guys. So, we have two raiders, well, three raiders. Well, everyone here is a raider, I should say. So I did bring up this topic a few weeks ago, but I really want to bring it up again. What do you guys would like to see from raid in Destiny 2? Now, I want to direct this question to you, Lulu, because I know you raid a lot. So how would you like to see raids changed in D2?
Well, I think what I like about the parts of the raids that I really enjoy, when you think of VoG and you think of like the how much you can explore that area, I think of like there are so many places in VoG you could explore, you could go to. You didn't even know if it did anything, but you could kind of explore that area. You think of that, and then you can think of the mechanics of like Wrath, where it involved everybody in the team. The six Guardians all had a specific role they needed to do. I think like kind of combining those two things into some sort of, I don't design raids, so I don't even know. But I want it to be something that's fun. I don't want it to be something like King's Fall, where it just feels more like King's Fall just feels stressful to some people. I enjoy King's Fall, but I know a lot of people don't feel that way about it. So I think if they can keep the fun aspect of like Wrath and like keep like the environment of the raid actually like make you allowed to explore it, like just see what like is hidden in those places, even if nothing is there. Like I've had some of the best moments in VoG just exploring the whole area of VoG, the Gorgon place, the like underneath, you know, where they have that chest now, like just all kinds of like places in VoG. It was really awesome to explore that. So that, and then just like the actual mechanics of the raid itself. I like having a role for every Guardian to do, but also like don't make it so pertinent that everybody has to be alive. So for instance, the Atheon encounter, the challenge is, you know, which is fine to be the challenge that everyone has to stay alive, but if that was the actual encounter for like the end of Atheon, I feel like it would get really frustrating for groups if someone did die and then you'd have to wipe over and over and over again. I personally like that it's the challenge. I do like that. But you don't also want to make it so frustrating for the entire group that if someone makes a smallest mistake that you can't recover from it. So like VoG, like it was nice, you know, complexes. If someone dies, you can still keep continuing. I like that if someone still made a mistake, you could still keep going. So I don't want it to get so like specific, whereas if someone dies, you have to wipe. But still kind of make it so everybody has a specific thing they need to be doing. Because that's what I really liked about Wrath is, you know, someone was throwing bombs, someone was doing cannons, all at the same time. And I liked that everyone had to do things at the same time. So just kind of that. And I don't know if maybe somehow, you know, I hope Destiny 2 has a lot of story elements to it. So maybe somehow, like, make the raid somehow more story-oriented, things like that. Mm-hmm. Like that. Like that's more, like, forefront, not just in the Grimoire, I guess, is what I'm saying.
So I do have a quick question. So for challenge mode, would you like to see challenge modes not be an option? Like, it ties into the mechanic more? Like, because, like, right now, challenge mode is an option. So what I'm trying to say in D2, like, it's not an option. Like, if it, like, they change the whole encounter when the challenge mode is active.
No, I still think making it an option is still, that's still okay. I don't think they have to change that necessarily. I guess, because I do, you know, there are times sometimes where just, you can't, you just have to say, you know, we're just going to complete it the regular way. Just not kind of working out right now with the raid group itself. But, I think, I mean, and also, like, you know, some people actually complain that the raids are too easy, so maybe make it even a more challenging mode for people. But I obviously think that could also get frustrating for, you know, people who can't play all the time. I don't really know how they would handle that, to be honest. Because if they make it too challenging, then just regular people wouldn't be able to, to complete it, like, if they can't play all the time. So, I don't know. I don't really know how to handle that, but I don't think they need to make it, like, set. I think having the option is good. You can or you can't. You don't have to do it.
Yeah. I'm just going back to Activision earnings call, and they did say that D2 is going to lean more to the casual player. So now as I'm thinking, I don't think raids are going to be as challenging as we hope for them to be, because they seem to be aiming for the casual player in D2. Now,
well, I think they did that in Destiny 1, too, though. Destiny 1, I think, really catered to the casual gamer.
Mm-hmm. For example, like the Three of Coins, like that's straight for casual players, and it kind of ruined the game for some people. At least for me, it did, because now I have every exotic in the game, and then exotics are quite. I'm going on to a whole different tangent, but Dan, your thoughts on what Lulu said?
Like, honestly, I think that, I agree tremendously with what she had to say.
Yeah.
I think that as long as they handle the raids where there's no cheese, there's no secret spots to do damage from, I'll be happy. There's some thing or like just minor glitchy stuff. I'll be happy. I've been living in the raids all this week, like for the past 3 weeks. I've put up a cot in between the two pillars next to Templar, and I've just been sleeping there. It's been fun, but somebody's got to keep dodging back and forth between the two spots in order to keep me from getting woken up by splash damage. So it's just been been tough, guys.
That's why you need a defender.
I need a defender, yeah.
That's why you need a defender, Dan.
I need a hero.
I hate splash damage. I've learned in VOG, splash damage is bad. I do not like splash.
Yeah.
Wow. Because no other raid has really splash damage, right?
I think War Priest does.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it the other day. Sure. I just know.
Yeah.
Unlucky.
You're right.
So is Crota. Cluster. Crota has splash too, if you miss.
Crota has splash. Axis has just SIVA hordes that fly around.
Yeah.
Like right, busy little bees.
Yeah. Alright, so Cluster, what would you like to see in D2? Like, from Rage in D2?
I want the raid to start in the rubble of the tower. I want it to be like, we're going home and we're going to try to take it back. Because obviously they're coming, and then they're going to come and stomp a mud hole in our chest and then walk it dry. So I kind of want to land into where we always land, you know, during Destiny 1, you know, with the something about the Guardians. On the, you know, just rubble everywhere, just smoking, where we where the postmaster used to be is the box hanging over, stuff like that. And I want that door to open by the speaker. That's what I want. I want to open that door to go into the raid because the tower is way bigger than we ever could imagine. And I'm just interested in seeing what the gear will look like because, you know, we know what Vex gear looks like. And we know what Hive looks like. Super. We know all about the Hive and all about the Fallen. But the Cabal, man, like, what's their gear going to look like? Is it going to be basically like the Fabian strategy, basically? You know, super militaristic, just functional. And I want to see. I mean, I'm interested. And I really want an Ahamkar raid, too. I just think it would look cool looking like a Dragon Knight as a Titan, personally. Just personally, like, a Dragon Knight would be the coolest thing ever. I would become a raider full-time if they have an Ahamkar raid. I said it on this show, episode 25 of the DTR podcast. I will become a full-time raider if there's an Ahamkar raid.
I hate to be that guy, but I do not think we're going to have... I don't think the first raid in D2 is going to be in the tower or in the last city. I think it's going to be on a like out in the wild. I would guess I will have to say Saturn, because a lot of people are saying that the majority of the game will take place on Saturn. So I hate to say it, but I don't think it's going to be in the tower.
Listen, I'm just happy to play it. I really don't care where it's at.
Of course, of course, of course.
I think at least the main, if not the raid, then the main story mission should be us, like, at least a portion of it should be us fighting our way back into the tower. Like, this place that was, you know, the last safe place on Earth, it was, you know, this safe haven for all of us Guardians, is now destroyed. Like, I want a significant portion of some part of the story to be, I just envision, like, Cade or someone saying, let's go take it back. You know, like, I could see this awesome speech from one of our, you know, main characters there, be like, you know, they came in, they destroyed it, let's go get it back. And, you know, it's up to you, Guardian, you know, something like
let's
that.
Let's get back our stuff.
Yeah.
And my stuff. My yeah, stuff I could more see particularly.
Go get back my stuff. But yeah, I mean, whether the raid is there or not, you know, so long as it weaves into the story, you know, like, Lulu, you touched on it. Like, raids in Destiny 2, I want them to feel more tied into the story. I think the closest that they did it was Crota, maybe. But even that, it's just like, it's almost like the dot on the I. As far as the raid, like, it's there, it's at the end of the story, but it doesn't really touch the story too much, you know? It's just kind of there. But I really think if you took Wrath and you took Vog and they had a baby, like, that would be the perfect raid.
No, I agree. Like, that's, like, there's things for both of them that I love so much. So, yeah, agreed.
And the way you went into it, like, Vog, where... Like, it's not so linear that there's nowhere you can explore. Like, Wrath, there's not really many places to kind of go off the path. Mm-hmm. There is a little bit, but it's really, really, you know, pretty
it's
linear.
Super linear. Super linear.
Whereas Vog, like, you could get lost in Vog, you know, and you could, oh, maybe I need to jump down here. Oh, shit, I died. I don't need to jump down there.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you took both of those raids and mash them up, I think you'd have the perfect raid. But, and I think we talked about, whenever we talked about what we want in raids in D2, I mentioned it. But in future raids, I want them to sort of break away from the mold that they formed, where there's one sort of relic, whether it's the sword in Crota or the relic in Vog, or like throwing the bombs in Wrath. You know, they tend to like have one new sort of thing, whatever it is, and then the whole raid for the most part centers around that thing. So all, like, throwing bombs in so many phases of Wrath,
the relic,
and using the relic in multiple phases of Vog, and using the sword to kill Crota, and, you know, it's always either a means to take the shield down and then damage the boss, or it's a way to damage the boss after you've already taken the shields down, sort of thing. And so I want them to sort of break away from this, like, you know, here's your thing, this is what you're going to have to use. Like, I want there to be more inventive and different ways of defeating encounters. And I, like I said before, I want a chase. I want, and oh, well, actually, not necessarily a chase, but I want, like, with every encounter, it's like you enter the room and it's like, this is the arena for your encounter. I want to have to go to different arenas during a single encounter. Like, mm-hmm. we need to go get this over here, or we need to go find this, like whatever, something. We need to go find the metaphorical switch to flip. And it, I want encounters to expand more area within the entire raid. So maybe you don't know exactly where you're going, you know, you got to go find something in a timely fashion while maybe the rest of your team is trying to hold off a horde of enemies. You know, I want them mm-hmm. to get a little more inventive with the encounters.
Yeah. Now, I don't know if you guys noticed, but D2 launches on a Friday, the same day we do our podcast. That show is going to be awesome. I can't wait.
I'm going to be gone. I'm going to be gone. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh man. Just so happens I have that week off. Bed.
Oh yeah.
I happen to take my vacation on that day, on that week, just sporadically.
I think the whole world is going
weird...
to be sick that day.
Do you guys think reset's going to switch to Friday now?
I hope so.
I hope so.
I think that would be great.
I do not like that.
That's interesting. I hadn't thought of if they were going to switch reset. And, oh, man.
If they're going for a more casual player, that actually makes sense.
Yeah.
Because Fridays. Because
yes, it does. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
TGIF.
Yeah.
It worries me though, because I just think about it, like right now, if reset was on Friday, you've got mm-hmm. trials, you've got like raids, like how are you going to do it all in like one day?
Well, you also
maybe trials won't be a thing.
Oh no, go ahead, sorry.
No, I feel like I have this thing where like, and I know you don't have to, you have a whole week to do it, but like when I get it done like day one, and so if everything comes out on reset, it's like, how am I going to do this?
Friday's going to be a long day.
There's a hope for me that maybe we don't have to prove ourselves to Osiris in Destiny 2.
Yes.
I think if we were more friendly with him, and like maybe something comes out like about a month later of just like a celebration or something along those lines, something like Trials. But maybe a little forgiving. Like I could, if that happened like once a month, kind of like Iron Banner. I don't know.
So I'm actually glad that you guys brought up the Trials of Osiris. Do you guys see Trials launching in D2 or in D2?
Yes.
Is it the
Mm-hmm. I actually enjoy Trials, so I kind of hope it does come back in some shape or form. I do think there are definite improvements that could be made to Trials, but I enjoy it. I don't know. I still like it. So mm-hmm. I hope it's not like gone completely. Like they replace it with something similar to it. It doesn't have to be exactly like Trials, but mm-hmm. I think it is fun. I mean, I enjoy the weekends for Trials when I can play it. So, and I know there's a lot of people who enjoy Trials. So I think if they took that out of Destiny, they're going to be losing a huge
portion
of people who actually do enjoy Trials. Like, there are people who do
really playing. Here's the thing that a lot of people forget. Osiris is always in Fireborn. He's always in Radiance. Like, he's mm-hmm. in Perma-Radiance. Now, that would mean that his connection with the Light is the most intense of any Guardian. Theoretically, we're going to lose our Light. Or the connection to the Light. Not lose it, because if we lose our Light, we become corpses. That's not what anybody wants. Then it'll be just a house of 1,000 of them. Now, what I think is we're going to go, obviously, into the wasteland and the wilderness and, you know, reestablish ourselves. But I think the Osiris expansion is going to be where the connection, he teaches us how to reestablish a personal connection with the Light. We're going to still have ghosts, obviously. You just don't mm-hmm. see them in the teaser trailer, because that's a lot of ghosts to animate, if you think about it. It's a ton of ghosts in one scene. Now, that's exactly... I think he's going to be the one who's going to be like, I've watched you in my trials. We need you. You are needed to face Gary. I know his name isn't Gary, but I call him Gary. You know, we all call him Gary. And here's how to do it. Here's how to find your Light. Here's how to open your door. We're not going to be in Perma Hammers or Perma Smash or Perma Bubble or whatever iteration our super is going to be, but that's how I think is going to be our step up to being able to become Max Light again. to be able to be the traveler's chosen, as it were. And I mean, I've been stewing on that for a while because I'm like, everybody forgets that Osiris is in permanent radiance. Mm-hmm. He is forever fireborn. That means he could throw grenades until the end of time.
Oh no, he's
using
that guy.
Stickies, the cheesy bastard.
Yeah, he's using stickies. Yeah.
No, he's using the flares. Just mini suns everywhere. Just you can't.
Come on, man.
Come at me.
I would hate that. Oh yeah. But you don't think they're going to save Osiris for the first expansion? Because the first expansion will be centered around him.
No, that's
well, I mean,
what I
we
think.
Like you see, yeah. I mean, you see the Trials emblem. Like, listen, we don't know shit yet.
It could be
about
the cult.
Yeah.
I mean, it's okay if they don't release it right away. Yeah. I just don't want it like gone for like the whole Destiny 2. I just want some version, some kind of version of it.
You don't have to call it the Trials of Osiris either, but like, I mean, I love Trials. Mm-hmm. You know, like, outside of the fact that, you know, that a lot of my stream, my personal stream, has been built through Trials and helping people in Trials, like, I legitimately enjoy the game mode. And I think that, you know, in the driest times of Destiny as far as content goes, I really think that Trials is what has helped bridge those content routes in a
That's
large
true.
Way.
Yeah.
I think it's you know, when the pulse of Destiny has been very faint, the pulse that was there in a large way was Trials. Mm-hmm. And you see it on Twitch, you know, like, I know Twitch only represents a fraction of the community, but you see it that, you know, come the weekend, you know, people streaming Trials, you know, tend to do pretty well. And, you know, a lot of people tune in to watch and a lot of people tune in to play. Yeah. You know, I think if they were smart, just from that aspect, they would have something similar, in Destiny 2.
That's an interesting question. Lulu and Pubin, mm-hmm. What would you like to see change in Trials for Destiny 2? Like, are there any, like, core features that you think could help improve Trials as a whole? Or maybe something that you could take out in order to improve it as a game mode.
Lulu, please hit it first.
I don't know specifically. I think they could still improve the matchmaking somewhat, though. I feel like, and I don't really know exactly what the fix is for that. I read some things on, you know, the Destiny Reddit, things like that. What some people suggest fixes are, but you know, just. The matches, I mean, and part of it now is because the player base has dwindled. So, you know, every match is going to feel like you're getting paired up against people who, are, you know, are all really good players. Because that's pretty much who's playing Trials right now. But the downside of that is when a more casual player goes into Trials, their first few matches are just going to be, you know, it's hard. It's really hard for a lot of players. So it's not, and I don't know how they fix the matchmaking. I don't particularly actually really like skill-based matchmaking, to be honest, so I don't really know what the answer is, but somehow make it so people feel like they have a more of a chance, I guess, to progress on their own individual Trials card. I do think the recent change they just did, though, with the adding the armor and stuff back to the bounties was a good change for just mm-hmm. the casual player, because they can now get the loot, some of the loot, while just, and that you know, that makes the player base larger too, if more people are playing because they want to get the loot. I don't really know those specific individual fixes. I think the special ammo economy needs to be changed for, I just, mm-hmm. It's okay for sixes, I feel like. It's not terrible for that. But for Trials, it's just, it's not in a good spot, I don't think, for Trials. I really hope they change that in Destiny 2. I think, you know, some people have suggested, you know, you start with everybody starts with the same amount of special ammo for the whole thing. You start with, say, like three rounds, like you start with three shoddy ammos, or you start with a specific amount of sniper ammo, and then once that's gone, you don't get any more for, like, the remainder of the rounds, things like that. But this whole special ammo economy is interesting. Even with the changes, it's still just, you know, just, I don't know. I don't know. I'm not the greatest at analyzing Trials at the moment, but I do think there are improvements.
Yeah, I do not like the special economy in Trials. It's just not for me.
Yeah. I mean, sixes feels fine. Like, I honestly, when I play sixes, six, I feel like it's fine. It spawns good. I'm like, you know, there's usually it's spawning pretty quickly in sixes. Like, I'm like, oh, this is fine. But trials, it's just unless you slow down the matches to where everybody can pick up special. And then it kind of feels like, okay, well, you slow it down, but it shouldn't necessarily need to be slowed down to play trials, I don't feel like. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. Special ammo economy right now in Trials of Osiris is in a bad spot. Arguably the worst spot it's ever been in. In my opinion, and I think in most people's opinion. And it's one of those things like special spawns 30 seconds into a match. So if you're trying to wait for special in a round that's 90 seconds long and you wait 30 seconds, then you have 60 seconds to either try and wipe the other team or get in a position to cap the point. I mean, you know, assuming that we have something that is similar to what Trials is now, and it's not a totally different form of kind of endgame PvP, I think spawns need to flip because just some maps, some spawns are more beneficial than others. I think you need to flip spawns like every other round, maybe just every other round, something like that. Something so if the map is unbalanced, each team will have the favorable side and each team will have the unfavorable side. I really want to see a 6v6 trials-esque game mode. I feel like what they have right now for their variant of that is Iron Banner, but it has to be something that feels different than just regular matchmaking. You know, even if you go play elimination during the week, trials feels different than elimination during the week. Can't explain why, but it has a different feel to it. But I want something in the 6v6 playlist that is on that same level as Trials of Osiris. I don't know what shape that would take. I don't know what it would look like, but I want to have something in that. I mean, and I look to Overwatch, you know, like Overwatch, you have this, you know, full fire team 6v6 and it's ranked. So even if there was like a 6v6 and a 3v3 ranked playlist where your regular pub playlist is just, you know, it's just randomly, you know, connection based. But then your skill, your ranked playlist is skill based, and then you had some sort of a ranking system similar to SR and Overwatch. I think that having those two different playlists would be pretty cool. And then you could even have something trials, something win based, not necessarily like ranking based, but win based with some sort of end game loot. I think they need to make for trials. I think the carrot on the end of the stick needs to be different. I don't think it should be gear, because then you potentially lock out certain people who can't get to the lighthouse from said gear. I think it could be something cosmetic, maybe, you know, an array of shaders or something, or even if it's an armor piece that comes without a stat roll, like we get these armor pieces now that they come with a light level of 3 and then you have to infuse something before they're useful. I don't know. So that way, like, you still have the prestige of getting to the lighthouse, in that you've completed that and you are, you know, skilled enough to get there or whatever the case, but you're not held back from getting loot that's beyond that barrier. But flipping spawns, rotating spawns, for goodness sake.
Yes, yeah.
So when do you guys think they're going to end off trials this year? Or do you guys think it's just going to continue throughout the lifespan of this game?
The servers are still going to be up for a while. Like,
yeah.
It wouldn't surprise me if they put it on some sort of autopilot where it just picks the map every week and, yeah.
Do you think that they might...
I think it's like that now. Oh, wait. Sorry, Dan.
Oh, no, you're fine. do you think that maybe they'll have, like, a cutoff date like they did with the legacy consoles? Where it's, like, up to this date, you'll still be able to achieve the lighthouse in Destiny 1?
I think eventually it'll get to a point where the servers, they won't do that. But, I mean, usually if you think about other games that have online multiplayer, they go on for quite a while after the game has stopped like producing updates. So I think it'll still be something that people can get to for a while, even probably up to at least a year, probably even longer than that. I don't know why they would have to just cut it, just turn it off. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how people are still going to be playing it, but I mean, I just think about other multiplayer games. The servers are still online for quite a while after the game has moved on to like its sequel or things like that. So
I don't know that for sure. I wonder if they change it because Trials is like an event. You know, it's not something that's always. So, I mean, it's a good question. I really don't know. Yeah, I don't know.
It doesn't matter much to me because once D2's out, I am off.
I think we're all on that. We're all there.
You will never see me step foot in Destiny 1 again. I'm moving on.
You'll see me do that on Easter to run Vault of Glass. That'll be my yearly holiday thing.
Yeah, I just think they're going to end off Trials and Iron Banana in August. I think August 2017, that's it. Because it's like Pubin said, it's an event. It's not something that's always here. So I feel like it's done August.
If they do, I think it'll run up until the weekend before Destiny 2.
Well, I bring this up because you guys know how before every expansion they always cut off Iron Banner and Trials. So that's why I'm saying
I
think they're going to cut it off before D2 launches.
Oh yeah.
Could be right about that.
Yes. I mean, but imagine it's the week before Destiny 2 comes out. And they're like,
hey everybody, Destiny 2 comes out next week. This is the last ever weekend of Trials of Osiris.
Do you know how many people would hop back in and play Trials on that very last weekend?
Oh, yeah.
A lot of people.
Especially if they said, and it won't be back like this in Destiny 2. Like, this is your last chance to ever play Destiny 1 Trials of Osiris. Even if they did, that period. But I think it would hold the most weight right before D2 when everybody's like, oh my god, it's coming in days.
I also bring this up this point because they're ending off the Asia Triumph record book. I think it's August 1st. That's the last day you'll be able to buy your shirt. Phew. So that's why I'm thinking about all of these end dates. Some like maybe Trials and Iron Banner is going to end. Like I'm looking at the future already. And
I would hope not. I would hope not.
Yeah. We shall see. We have months to talk about this.
Yeah. It's all speculation.
Yeah. And that's the best part. I love this time when we get to speculate about what's to come. But hey, May 18th.
Hey, speculation's fun, but I just want to dig into it. It is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just like that new Star Wars!
Like Star Wars! Oh my god, what did he mean when he said the end of the Jedi?
I don't know!
Dan, we need to start a Star Wars podcast.
Dude, let's do that.
We can be the not-so-Jedi.
We could start up a Star Wars Battlefront tracker. Hey, Tracker Network? Wait. No?
Did you guys just say Thor Ragnarok? I mean, Planet
Buster! We should start up a Thor podcast.
Let's just say, it's a great time to be alive. Yeah. It's a wonderful time to be alive as far as entertainment goes.
Entertainment, there we go.
There are some asterisks.
Asterisks.
Right now in the nerdy corner of the universe, it's all good.
Yes. Far as nerd culture, there is some shit going on.
In the geekosphere?
Things are good. Which is where I go to escape from the other things that are going on in the world.
Same.
Yeah.
Yes.
My final question for the night is a heated topic on Twitter right now. And I think we should discuss it.
Oh, no.
Where do you guys get your burgers from? Do you guys like Five Guys? Do you guys like
this shit!
Because this is a heated topic.
Let's do this!
Someone hold me back!
It needs to be discussed.
I ain't holding you back!
But I will please guests. Okay, Lulu, Buster, you guys go first because this is going to get emotional.
Okay. All right. So I saw that question, and between the two options that were posted, I don't even know what Shake Shack is. I don't think they have those where I live.
All right. Sorry.
It's fine. You don't
have
to worry.
I'm a New Yorker.
There's only one real answer.
Well, so the Five Guys that was listed is very, very good. I feel like Five Guys, though, is like I'm drunk, I want to eat really greasy food, I'm going to Five Guys. Or at least in my town, because it was in the college. It's located on, like, the college campus. Okay. But the Five Guys, what makes it so good, though, are the french fries, though, that they put in the bag with the hamburger.
Yes. Yes.
Because they give you so many. So I would say between those two options, Five Guys, because I've never had Shake Shack. But I can't really
say. If you did not have the choices of Five Guys or Shake Shack, where else? Like, if you want a burger, where do you go? Like, a nice, good-tasting burger.
Honestly, it would be Five Guys, because the only other places here in towns are, like, Wendy's, Burger King, and McDonald's, and while I will eat a burger from any of those places, like, it's, I'm trying to think if there's anything else here and where I live. Like, there's
restaurants?
Really...
It doesn't have to be fast food. It's just a good place to get a burger.
Okay, let me think of this, and I'll get back to you. Let's see if there's anything else here.
All right.
Because I don't know.
Buster, you man. Burgers.
Oh, man, I've had burgers. I've had burgers everywhere. I mean, you could even add In-N-Out to that discussion. But I've had, you know, I've had In-N-Out. I've had Shake Shack. I've had Five Guys. The best burger I've ever eaten in my entire life, however, was from a food truck. It was... Oh man, this is so bad. It's just the worst thing for you. It's a Krispy Kreme donut cut in half, grilled down, and a bacon cheeseburger in between. Amazing.
I mean, I love Krispy Kremes. I don't know how I feel about it mixed with meat, but it could work.
I mean, when you have bacon and like waffles, do you put like does your syrup touch the bacon and you still eat it? It's the same principle, sweet and savory. It's delicious.
It touches the syrup, at least mine. But yeah, In-N-Out Burger, when I went to Vegas, In-N-Out Burger was my first time. It was really good. I recommend.
From the suggested one, Five Guys.
I enjoyed In-N-Out when I went to California, but for actual burgers, though, Five Guys is just...
Yeah.
It's good. Like,
have you guys ever heard of Smash Burger? It might just be...
No.
I've been to Smash Burger.
Oh, okay.
I've yet to go there. Right. I'm about to blow the doors right wide off this though. So Pubin, I want you to go first.
Listen, if I want a freaking burger, I'm not going to fucking Five Guys. I'm not going to. I don't know what Shake Shit Shack is, but I'm going to a place that makes burgers. Properly, okay. Basically, I'm not going to any. You can call me a burger snob. I suppose I might be, but I am going somewhere that makes
a burger hipster. Maybe
possibly. I go somewhere that makes finely crafted burgers, and I can pair it with a beautiful beer of some kind. And that's that's all I got to say about that. I want nice fresh toppings. I maybe want a fried egg on top. If you haven't had
beautiful.
Yes. Ooh.
Oh,
yes.
Where is this restaurant? What is the name of the place?
So down in Florida, down like where I'm at in Arkansas,
his parents' house.
Actually, like I do enjoy cooking my own burgers or home cooked burgers, like right off the grill, you mix all the meat and stuff yourself.
Oh, yeah.
But like if we're going out, like if we're all here together and we're like, hey, guys, let's go out and get burgers. Like, so there's a place in South Florida where I'm from South Florida. That's where I live. I'm just up here in Arkansas taking classes because I have to for my PhD. There's nowhere to get a damn burger around here. But back down home, there's a place called, and I'm pretty sure it's a chain, like it's a franchise. There's beer and burger joint. And like they make these big, beautiful burgers that are, I mean, they ain't cheap, but they're really just super tasty. They cook it. Like, let me put it this way. If you're going somewhere that doesn't ask you how you want your burger cooked, that is not somewhere I'm going to get a burger from. And so, like, they have a wonderful beer selection. They have nice fresh toppings. They have, like, top quality meat. And the burger comes with a big, thick, beautiful bun. Like, man, it's to die for. In Puerto Rico, there was a place that did stuffed hamburgers. I worked in Puerto Rico last summer for, like, 3 months for my research. And there was a place in Puerto Rico that they stuffed their burgers and they had multiple different options. But like the one I kept having was like plantains, which is like bananas, like fried plantains and bacon stuffed inside of a hamburger. It was one of the most insane burger experiences and unique burger experiences I've ever had. But yeah, man, like, take me somewhere where they'll say, "And how do you want that cooked?" And I'll say, "Rare."
Dan, can I intercede 1 second? I'm sorry.
Buster, I'm gonna let you finish. Go ahead.
If you're on Instagram and you don't follow Swain Stash, you're missing out on some of the greatest burgers in the history of mankind. His restaurant, Rex 1516 in Philadelphia, is it's my death meal. Like, if they say you have one meal before you die, I'm going there. Every week they have a featured burger, which has some, I think this week's had spicy cheddar cheese, tater tots, bacon, and a garlic aioli. Amazing. If you don't follow at Swain Stash on Instagram, please do so.
Swain posts a lot of his pictures on Twitter.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, they look insane.
But I'm sorry, God. Dan. I love you, buddy.
I love you, too. Missing from the conversation, I believe, is the musical genre of metal. And there is one burger joint that merges burgers and metal perfectly together. It is called Kuma's Corner. There's about 5 of them in the world. One of them being in Chicago. One of them in Indianapolis, where I call home, right around the corner. Let me
now
read
I know
you.
Where Dan lives.
I live really close to Dan too. But yes. I've never heard of this place.
It is.
Lulu,
oh my God!
Go there. I want to hear from you.
Lulu, let's get a bunch of people together and go to Kuma sometime.
But I might have to try it out.
Hey, Destiny,
there's actually
meetup?
Some people in your chat right now that live in Indianapolis too, because I've met
yes.
them.
Let's do that. Let's do that. That would be really fun. But Kuma's Corner, let me just, oh my God, okay. This burger, I've got the menu up right now and I'm salivating. Lair of the Minotaur. It has brie, bourbon, peach, pear, caramelized onions, and pancetta.
Ooh, caramelized. Oh,
caramelized. Oh, my God. The mastodon, applewood smoked bacon, cheddar, frizzled onion, barbecue sauce.
I could eat that one.
Mm-hmm.
Plague bringer. This one can be a bit rough, okay? Crushed pepper jam, jalapenos, tortilla strips,
he's back.
Roasted garlic, mayo, lettuce, tomato, red onion. Guys, I'm a fan of this place. It makes me feel good in my tum-tum, and there's metal music on the entire time you're eating. It's pretty great.
Have any of you guys ever done, like, burger eating challenges, like where you have to eat a ridiculously large burger?
I've done a wing eating challenge.
How many wings did you eat?
16.
Were they like super spicy?
Yes, and it was within 4 minutes.
Whoa.
I was not feeling good the rest of the day.
I ate a 5-pound burger one time.
Yeah.
Gross.
It was 3 pounds of meat, 1 pound of bun, 1/2 pound of lettuce, and 1/2 pound of tomato. I've never felt so shitty for 2 days in my life.
Man, for me, burgers, I like Five Guys. There's this place in Manhattan called Blues. Really, really good burgers. I recommend it. If you live in New York City, go to Blues. It's on 58th Street on the east side between Park and Lexington, I believe. Yeah, it's really good. And if I want a quick burger, I have to go to Five Guys. Yeah, it's just me. Wow.
The photos on that site, Dan.
Yeah, Dan, this place looks amazing, and they have good beer because I see one that has Golden Monkey, and I love it.
Dude, they have great local beer. Indianapolis right now has a really great brewery scene. Oh, it's so good. Ah, my gut.
I'm coming over. Whose house can I sleep at?
This one right here. Come on by.
Let's go, Dan.
All right, let's do this.
I hate all Arkansas. Right. No offense to anybody who lives in Arkansas potentially in chat. I just don't like it.
Well, Pubin, I have to say, there is a Five Guys across the street from the Guardian Con place, so it looks like we will be going there this year.
Looks like you'll be going there. I'll be going to the places that serve real food.
Lulu, we have to take him to Five Guys, okay? We have to.
We'll take him to Five Guys.
I ate there once, and I just have
a few drinks, and then Five Guys sounds like the best place in the world, so it's not too hard.
Yeah, and listen, at Guardian Con, I'm not going to shy away from the beverages filled with ethanol. But, after that, listen, get me a few of those and I'll eat pretty much anything.
Oh my God.
Outside of that.
All right, guys. Wow. Great episode. Great episode, guys. Well, thank you for listening to the 25th episode of the DTR podcast. Thank you, Lulu and Buster, for joining us this week. Thank you so much. We had fun.
Thanks for having me, man. I enjoy it.
Thank you. I appreciate the invite.
Yes, you guys can always come back.
Yes. Yes. Anytime, please.
And we could discuss more food change and food next time. All right, guys. So, Lulu, let's start off with you. Where can we find you on social media?
On Twitch. My name is Lulu Soccer. And then same with Twitter is Lulu Soccer. PSN is Lulu Soccer. I don't have an Instagram. I don't have like any of the other stuff, but mainly just Twitter and Twitch, Lulu Soccer. I do play Xbox, Lulu Twitch. That's where you find me at.
Sweet. And Buster, where can we find you on social media?
You can find me. My personal Twitter is BusterKnuckle13. That's BusterKnuckle13. But I run the RNGCast Twitter, and I'm mainly on that. And that's at the RNGCast. And you can find us on Twitch at twitch.tv/TheRNGCast, and you can find us on iTunes, Podbean, Google Play, Stitcher, SoundCloud.
I stopped with that too. Yeah.
Yeah. Patreon.com/TheRNGCast if you want to support our Patreon, which gives you exclusive content and early access to the podcast episodes. And, I'm definitely going to have all of you guys, not at the same time, and Lulu, I'm sorry, I say guys, meaning everyone together,
as
guests on the podcast, because I had super fun talking to you guys.
Thank you.
And, Pubin, I will be seeing you, sir, at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
For sure, dude.
And Dan, I always see you in the mornings when I do my workouts.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Love you, brother.
Also, we need to work out a time this month, probably next Saturday or something like that. I'm free.
Cool.
For your purposes.
I'm always there.
I know you are, and I'm proud of you.
Dirty Dan, back at it again, y'all.
He's just embracing it at this point.
I know, right?
I am leaning hard into this Dirty Dan thing. I'm really...
And I appreciate it.
I like that, Dan.
I sell it all the day, guys. And I... It was a day.
Alright, guys. But yeah, check out the RNGCast. They are part of the DTR network. Make sure you guys check them out. So, Pubin is the favorite part of the show. Where can we find you on social media, man?
Yes, because everything's the same now. It's not trigger happy anymore. You can find me at twitch.tv/Pubin_games. I stream there like 5 or 6 times a week. We have a lot of fun, and go follow me on there, and we're making the push for 5,000 followers over there, so it's pretty exciting.
Nice, congrats!
you can also follow me on Twitter at Pubin_games, again, because everything matches now, it's so nice. You can also find me here on twitch.tv/DestinyTrack right after the podcast. I will be doing trials runs with my usual Friday partner, Hanuman. If you don't know him, he's one of the best players in the world. Mm-hmm. And first up tonight, we are playing with Dirty Dan, trying to get him to the Lit House for his first time.
Yes.
It's going to be a lot of fun, and hopefully we get it done. Han and I tend to play pretty well together. And Dan, I have a feeling, is just gonna go off tonight.
Lighthouse Virgin.
I'm ready. I'm ready to demolish some stuff.
Let's go.
Let's go. All right, now Dan, where can I find you on social media?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram @DanFinitwitch, and on Twitch itself, under twitch.tv/danfinity. You could also just find me just at a local library. Just
serving you. Whenever. Helping old ladies cross the street.
Helping old ladies cross the street. In the dark sewers where Dirty Dan lives.
Reading To Kill a Mockingbird.
Or A Portrait of Dorian Gray. It's one of those. It's been a day, and I love you guys. Thank you so much for being with us.
Dan, do you need a hug?
Oh man, hug? I'm gonna go hug Ginny as soon as this is over with. Okay. As soon as this is done, I'm gonna go hug Ginny. I'm gonna take like a 10-minute breather, and then I'll be back.
Lieutenant Dan, go hug Ginny.
I'm going to.
All right, guys. So you guys can follow Destiny Tracker on Twitch at Destiny Track, which we're almost at 2,000 followers on this channel. Yes.
Yeah.
The channel's growing. I like that. You guys can subscribe to us on YouTube at Destiny Tracker. You can find the podcast on iTunes, Podbean, and the Google Play Store at Destiny Tracker Podcast. You guys can follow us on Twitter at Destiny Track. You guys can follow me on Twitter at J_DTR. Whew. That's a lot.
Hey, Jay, do we have one more piece of business?
Yes. Yes, so tell us.
I think we do.
Tell us about Level Up Foods, man.
Well, I will. Hey, do you ever find yourselves in the Cosmodrome and your like stomach starts to like get all like weird and stuff? Or like maybe you're hanging out on the Dreadnought and you're like, man, I am parched. Might I have a drink from this void? No, don't do that. That's just gross. What you need to do, you need to visit our friends at Level Up Foods. They've got snacks to keep you fighting fit. Level Up Foods have a wide variety of options like Guru Energy Drinks, Country Archer Original Beef Jerky, Kind Bars. The selection is enormous. You can even subscribe to a box service to have some of these products brought to your door each month. Don't I'm store this.
What? I am.
Who's a subscriber? You should be too. Don't put this in your vault because Gary's gonna come and fuck that shit up. You can order a box today and use our promo code ITSLIT17 for 10% off your next order. That's ITSLIT17 to receive 10% of some of these delicious snacks. We'd like to thank our friends at Level Up Foods, and we want to thank you for your support. And we'll see you later.
Thank you so much. Get that honey badger.
And if you do order from Level Up Foods and use our promo code, let us know on Twitter.
Yes, let us know. We will retweet that. We will retweet that. Let us know.
Ooh, give you our gratitude.
Oh man,
I'm still waiting for some free shit from Level Up Foods. I don't know what the deal is. You know what I'm saying? I'm pretty parched from the Dreadnought.
Soon, we gotta do the giveaways.
I'm wanting a Kind Bar.
Soon. I promise you. All right, guys. Well, thank you for listening to the 25th episode. My name is Jay, and we will see you all next week with Ninja with No L. It's gonna be a great show. See you all next week.
Yes. Talk about shapes.
Yeah. And I'll see you tomorrow, brother.
All right, yeah, guys. Man, definitely. Have a good night, dude.
You too, man.